about a few concepts of how stimulator emission can take place in laser. So the first thing which you need is population inversion. That means you should have more number of atoms in the higher energy level than the low energy level. Second one, there is active medium. Active medium is the medium where you have all the atoms. Let me just go to full screen. So you have all the atoms, whichever atoms are going to help in this process of population inversion. You call them as active centers. And the medium which consists of these atoms, be it a solid medium or a gaseous medium, you will call them as active medium. Now, another process is pumping. Pumping is required so that you get population inversion. That means your initial condition, you have lots of atoms in the lower energy level, but you need now more atoms in the high energy level. So for that reason, you need to give some external source of energy, because of which you will let all these atoms go to the high energy level, and then some stimulated emission take place. So for that, there are three ways of giving that external source of energy. One is optical pumping, that is when you use a light source. Second is electrical discharge, that is you create an electric field. Suppose I have a gaseous medium, I can give some potential and create an electrical discharge, like how it happens in your normal tubes and everything, any gaseous medium. Next, there is another option where you can convert directly the electrical energy into light. Now, if you have to understand how pumping happens, then the one concept of metastable state you need to know. What is this metastable state? High energy levels or the excited energy levels, the atoms are unable to stay there for a longer time, because the lifetime there is like of the order of nanoseconds. So they end up very quickly moving from there. So you don't get sufficient time for stimulated emission to take place. So that means there has to be another energy level in which the atoms can stay for slightly longer time and stimulated emission can take place. That is known as a metastable state. So here the lifetime of the atoms or the it can stay for almost like in order of milli to microseconds, almost 1,000 to 1,000,000 times better than your higher excited level. So we need population inversion. Only if you have population inversion, stimulated emission can take place, and then laser light will come off. So there are different ways of pumping, different ways in which you can let the population inversion take place and stimulated emission can happen. One of them is, I will say, three-level pumping scheme. So three-level basically means three energy level. I have E1, E2, E3. Now let's see what are these. E1 is the ground energy level, okay. E3 is the excited energy level, and E2 is the metastable energy level. Energy level of states. So state, I will call it as a state, just to say that that is where they are occupying, the electrons or atoms are occupying the position. Now, when in a three-level case, what happens is, I gave some external source of energy, right? I gave some light or electrical discharge or something I gave. And because of that, atoms or electrons, they will excite from this energy level E1, that is ground energy level, go to this excited energy level, E3. Okay? Obviously, they are unstable there. They cannot sit there for a longer time. So they will quickly come down to this metastable level. The metastable level lies in between, okay? Not exactly in between, somewhere there in between. So they come down to this metastable stage, okay? Now, when they are in the metastable stage, okay, you have the atoms and the electrons, you have the metastable state. Now, you can see this right-hand side figure. There is one photon coming into picture, randomly. One random photon coming into picture. That is going to trigger the stimulated emission. It is going to interact with the atom here at the metastable state. It will trigger the stimulated emission and photons will come out. But obviously, along with stimulated emission, there is a spontaneous emission. So you get two photons. This point you have to remember. spontaneous emission happens always, but stimulated emission is what is actually going to give you that high amount of amplification and high amount of intensity or high amount of light. Now, what happens here? What did we say? There are three energy levels. One is a ground energy level, next is a pumping energy level, and then you have a metastable energy level or state. I will say it as a state or energy level. Now, initially, you had an external source of energy, light or electrical discharge or whatever it was. That is going to raise all these atoms to the high energy level. So obviously this is absorption, and all the atoms get excited to the excited level and the high energy level. There they are unstable, so they will decay. There is no radiation here. When they just come down here, they just lose some energy by some non-radiative process and they come down to metastable level. Now when you are when the atoms are in the metastable level, a random photon is going to trigger the stimulated emission, and then you will get this thing. Now, where did population inversion happen? That is the main question, right? So you had all these atoms going to the upper level E3 and then coming down to E2, right? So before stimulated emission, before this photon triggers the process, it end up accumulating more atoms here. You can see this figure, I expanded here, right? I have put more atoms here. There are more atoms which have now come. Only once you get more number of atoms in level E2 than the level E1. Okay? Right? Only when you have more number of atoms in the metastable level, this metastable level here, you will have the chance for stimulated emission. So all the atoms went up first to high energy level. From there, they came down to metastable level. Now, in metastable level, they accumulated, many number of atoms accumulated. And when some sufficient density of atoms have been accumulated, some sufficient number has been accumulated, the photon will trigger stimulated emission. Now, this is three-level pumping scheme because you have three energy levels. Ground level, upper energy level, or you can also call it as a pumping level because you're pumping it and moving from ground state to high energy level. And then there is a metastable level. This is three-level. So next comes four-level. Okay, next comes four-level. So what happens here? There is E1, there is E4, and there is E3 and E2. So previous you had only E1, E3 and E2. Here it is E1 is the ground energy level, E4 is that higher energy level. Then there are two states here, two metastable states. There is E3 and there is E2. There are two energy levels here, E3 and E2. Now let's see what happens here. Once again, ground state. You have initially all the atoms, you give some external source of energy, be it some light or electrical discharge. It absorbs that energy and the atoms get excited to the excited level, which is this level number 4, E4. Okay. Now from here, they decay or they lose energy by some non-radiative process and settle into this metastable state E3. Okay. They come down to this level E3, third level. Now, they keep on accumulating here, right? They come from 4 to 3 and keep on accumulating here. So now you see this figure. So once a number, particular number has been reached, particular density of atoms has been reached, particular number of atoms have been reached, then stimulated emission can take place. A photon comes and interacts with these atoms and results in stimulated emission. Okay? Now, where is stimulated emission happening? It is happening between these two energy levels, between 3 and 2. There are two metastable energy levels in which you have few atoms. But obviously, the level E3 will have more number of atoms than the level E2. When accumulation happens, more atoms settle at E3 than E2. So you can see only two I have shown here in E2, while here there are so many. Right? In 3, it is so many. So I can call this as upper lasing level and this is lower lasing level. Okay, upper lasing level and lower lasing level. So between 3 and 2 stimulated emission thickness. Now at the end, obviously these are still whatever leftover the few atoms which are there, who are there, they are still at a high energy level. So they have to attain equilibrium, they come down to level E1. Once again, the process, if even more number of atoms come in E1, you apply more energy, you give some optical light or electrical discharge. Again, you send them all back to E4. From E4, they will come to E3. They will start accumulating. A lot of them will accumulate in E3. A few will accumulate in E2. Between 3 and 2, you will have the stimulated emission. So this is 4-level pumping scheme. So it keeps on happening as long as you have given the supply. Okay. Now, we need to see some lasers working and principle of some lasers which are used commonly. Okay. Before that, there is one more thing. So at the end, when all your pumping, all this process happens, stimulated emission happens, we saw in the previous class that there is a multiplication of these photons, right? There were two became four, those four resulted into eight became 16, 32, like that. It went on to the in the power of twos, right? You end up getting so many photons or amplification was happening. But you need to finally take out all these photons, right? So how do you do that? So with that, there is something called as optical resonant cavity. Simple understanding. Whatever is your medium, whatever is the stuff in which all this surface of or all this process of inoculation, inversion, stimulated emission, everything takes place. So this is the medium. Okay. And there is one mirror here on the left hand side, which is a 100% reflecting mirror. Okay. And this side is a semi-transparent mirror. So just think of this. All your stimulated emission take place. The multiples of photons are produced here, 2 to the power of n. Okay, so many photons are produced here. Those fellows are going to reflect between these two, mirrors. Multiple times they will bounce back and forth. Now, why is this made semi-transparent? So that at the end, there is some light, which is the final light, amplified light will come out. So multiple times when they reflect like this, intensity will increase. Intensity increases. So whenever you have all the stimulated emission population, you do pumping, population inversion happens from metastable to whatever is the level, stimulated emission take place. And then you have so many photons, it goes in a multiplication process, 2 to 4, 4 to 8, 8 to 16, 16 to 32, 64, like that it goes on. And then you end up getting so much of light, so many photons, right? Now you have to take them out. So for that, what you are doing is there is a fully reflecting mirror and one partially transparent mirror. Now, between these two mirrors, these photons will keep on reflecting. They will just keep bounce here and there. They will get reflected multiple times. So when that happens, the intensity of the photons increases. And at the end, when you take out whatever comes out of this semi-transparent mirror, you will get a nice intense beam of light. So optical resonant cavity is also one of the components within a laser system. So now moving on to, before that, let me quickly tell you a few important characteristics of a laser beam. First one is coherence. This thing we already see. I'm basically summarizing it, okay? Coherence. What did we say coherence? They all will have the same phase. All the waves coming out, all the photons coming out, if I consider them as waves, all of them will be in phase. And next, monochromaticity, that means all of them have the same frequency, wavelength or energy. Now, another one is directionality. What is directionality? All of them will travel in same direction. It comes only in one direction. Your laser beam comes out only in one direction. So if you have seen people, actually, if you take a small laser beam, which we usually use like while showing some presentations, when people show some presentation, there will be a small laser beam. So for that laser beam, it is just a small narrow line. It is very narrow. The width is very, It is very narrow and it travels longer distance and it emits light only in that particular direction. Okay, so there is a directionality. Another one, high intensity, you already studied this. Everything is happening with all this process, we will get a very high intense laser beam. So four important properties, coherence, directionality, monochromaticity, and high intensity. Now, yes, the types of lasers. There are two types of lasers which you have to learn. The first one which we are going to learn today is NDAG laser. You might have heard the term NDAG. So if there are, if some of you, maybe the girls or somebody, if you have visited some skin clinic, some dermatologists, if you have seen, they use some lasers for skin treatment. So that is usually NDAG laser. Okay, or else there is also a diode laser. That is what you will learn in the next class. So today you will learn NDAG laser. Now, what is this NDAG? So basically, it is referring to something neodymium. So it's N with a small d is neodymium, doped neodymium, doped yttrium aluminium garnet. A pretty long name. If you try to disconnect with each of them, neodymium, yttrium, aluminium garnet. If this is actually a solid state material, so we call it as a solid state laser. So your active medium, so-called active medium, is now a solid state material. It's a solid material. Okay. Now, what is going to happen is this is a four-level laser system. That means there are four energy levels. So pumping scheme is the four-level pumping scheme which you have learned. Now, it can operate in both pulsed and continuous mode. Pulse means like in shots, one by one it will come. Okay, the beam will come one by one. Continuous means obviously a continuous beam will come out. But NDAG laser, I don't know if you have noticed, you are unable to see whatever is coming out of the laser. The reason is it emits in the near infrared region. It is not in optical light. You know the electromagnetic spectrum, there are radio, microwave, infrared, then you have optical, ultraviolet, x-ray, like gamma ray, like that, right? So if there is an emission happening in optical, like the BG or the different branches, like the different colors, then you are able to see. Whichever we are able to see with our eye, obviously I can see the beam of light. But in NDAG, it comes out in infrared. So for that region, you are unable to see it. Infrared radiation, you cannot see. For an example, the simplest one I will say, there is one LED in the remote control at your home and it is actually producing infrared radiation. You are not seeing it. It is that infrared radiation which is helping to for you to switch the channels or increase or decrease the volume and all those things. Okay. So it emits in different wavelengths. So these are a few wavelengths at which it is emitting. 1064 nanometer and then few more at 1440 nanometer, 1320, 1120 and 940 nanometers. These numbers you should know, and main point is you should know that it is in near infrared region. It is not optical. It is not an optical light which comes out of the laser. Now let's see how this is constructed. So this cylindrical stuff which you are seeing is actually is your material, the NDAG material. So it's a crystal actually. It is a crystal. It's a crystalline structure. So you have the NDAG material. This is your active medium. Okay. Now there are these mirrors. So I said there will be a fully reflecting mirror, 100% fully reflecting mirror. Then there will be a partial mirror, semi-transparent or partially reflecting mirror, right? So that you can take out whatever is coming out. And then, so we said there has to be some pumping source of energy, some source of energy which will let all these atoms go from the low energy to high energy, and then you get all the stimulated emission, population inversion, I would say. Population, in order to get population inversion, you need to do the pumping. So we said there are different ways of pumping. One was optical pumping. So here also it is optical pumping. So you are using something like a flash tube. So flash tube is just like a small tube kind of structure. It is just enclosed within a glass surface. You apply a voltage like how your normal tube is there at home. I mean, not the LED tubes, the other ones, the pretty older tubes, the normal one, discharge tubes. It is a bit similar to that. So you apply a voltage, then it produces current. Or produces light, I will say. Current is being produced, then converted into light. So it produces light. So there is an optical light which is coming that is going to help in the pumping process. Now, the main thing is this. It's the neodymium ions or neodymium atoms which are going to do the entire process of inversion and stimulated emission. neodymium. It's a mix, right? Neodymium, drought, yttrium, aluminium, garnet, crystalline material. But in which you have so many components like neodymium, yttrium, aluminium, all these things. But what is going to help in this entire process is the neodymium. Okay. Now, and then let's move in understanding how it works. So here it is. So four level pumping scheme. So you have level 1, level 4, level 3, level 2. Right. So similar to what you studied earlier. Now, initially, what do you have? You have more number of atoms here, right, at E1 than the others. More number of atoms here. You are given your flash tube. You switched on your flash tube. That will supply some energy. That photons will come here. These atoms will absorb those photons, energy from those photons, and go to the level E4. It will go to level 4, right? It will go to level 4. Once again, level 4 is the highest level, highest excited level. So there they are unable to stay for a longer time. So in this particular case, it is mentioned 230 microseconds. If I say in nano, it will be around 0.23 nanoseconds. Okay. So around 230 microseconds is the lifetime in the case of this particular laser in the level E4. So obviously they are unable to sit there for a longer time. Nanoseconds means smallest one, right? So they are unable to sit there for a longer time. So what they do? They come down to level 3. They come down to level 3 and they start accumulating in level 3. Many of them will accumulate in level 3 and a few will accumulate in level 2. Okay, before proceeding to level 2, let's see what happens. Many of them will keep on accumulating here. Okay, fine. So you get your population inversion. So let me repeat. I'm going to the next slide for the continuation of the figure. I had so many atoms here at the level E1 initially. I switched on the flash tube. The photons on the flash tube, they fall on these atoms in E1. These atoms will absorb energy from these photons. Go to the level E4. They will go to E4. That is why you can see these dotted arrows. They will go to the level E4. At E4, they cannot stay for a longer time. So they come down to level E3. That is your metastable energy level. They will come down to this level E3. And they keep on accumulating until the situation achieves. What is the situation? You get more number of atoms in level 3 than level 2. Okay? You should have more number of atoms in level 3 than level 2. Now, next, what happens is a slight deviation, what is studied in the 4-level scheme. Obviously, it is a 4-level, but there is a small deviation happening. There is a small change before stimulated emission can take place. Now, from level 3 to level 2, okay, so listen carefully. If your previous 4-level pumping scheme, which you are studying, it was supposed to be stimulated emission between 3 and 2 as soon as you get population inversion here, right? But now, what is going to happen is, between 3 and 2, in this particular type of laser, that is your NDR laser, a spontaneous emission is going to take place. It's going to be a spontaneous emission. Okay. So spontaneous emission takes place. So then what happens? Whatever photon has come out of this spontaneous emission, those fellows, you can see this figure, those fellows again go and hit these leftover atoms at level 3. Okay. So from level 3, spontaneous emission takes place. So in spontaneous emission, they emit light. That photons will go and hit these atoms which are in the level 3. They are in the level 3. Now what happens? Stimulated emission takes place. You needed a photon to actually trigger the stimulated emission. From where that came? That came because of this spontaneous emission between 3 and 2. So first spontaneous emission happened and then that photon went and hit the atoms at 3 and stimulated emission happens. Okay, stimulated emission happens. So as usual, we will get two photons coming out. That gets multiplied. 2 become 4, 4 to 8, 8 to 16, 16 to 32. Like that, it goes on until you get 2 to the power of n, where n is the initial number of photons. Now, at the end, what do we have? All these photons have come out. They will keep on reflecting between these mirrors. right? Multiple times you'll keep on reflecting, intensity will increase, and at the end, whatever intense beam is there, that comes out of the partial reflecting mirror or the semi-transparent mirror. It comes out of this particular mirror. So let me repeat again what happens in NDR. It's a four-level scheme with a small deviation. All atoms initially at the level one. Your apply switch on your flash tube, photons can come and hit these atoms which are in the level one. They will be raised to level four, basically gain energy and go to level four. From level four, they are unstable there. They are unable to sit there for a longer time. So they come down to level three. Then what happens? From level three to two, obviously at level three, they have to achieve population inversion. That means more number of atoms should get accumulated here than the level two. Now between three and two, at first there is a spontaneous emission which is taking place. That means on its own it is coming down and producing a photon. And now this photon goes and hits the other atoms which are there in this level three. Okay, so first a spontaneous emission happened, new photon came, this photon go and hit the other atoms which are there in level three. Then between level three and two, you have the stimulated emission happening. Then afterwards, all of these which are there in two, they have to obviously lose energy and come down to energy level one. If they keep on accumulating here, again you switch on your flashlight, you do pumping, entire process goes on happening, it keeps on repeating. Okay, now one thing I want to say, not just flash tube. So earlier they were using flash tube. There is another option, you can use laser diodes. You can use laser diodes, that means semiconductor laser. That semiconductor laser you learn next. So that you can even use semiconductor laser and then do this pumping process in the case of this NDR. So that is just, it is understood that it is more economical, it's highly efficient and less costly. So for that reason, nowadays it is a laser diode instead of flash tube. So either flash tube or laser diode, principle remains the same. This fellow, whatever is here, that is a pumping source that is going to give some energy, some photons, that photons will come and hit in the active medium, the active centers, the atoms. Atoms in the neodymium atoms, those fellows interact with the photons, go to level four. From level four, they come down to level three. Population inversion happens, you get more atoms in level three than level two. First, there is a spontaneous emission. There is a spontaneous emission, one photon is produced. That photon goes and hit the other atoms in level three. Stimulated emission happens, you get two photons. That two goes and hit others, produces more photons, 4, 8, 16, 32, like that it goes on happening, you get more number of photons or amplified light. Finally, all the light will get reflected between these mirrors multiple times and you get a very highly intense, coherent, monochromatic, directional beam. These are the four properties. You need to remember that. Highly intense, coherent, that means all are in the same phase. Monochromatic, same frequency. And directional, that means only in one direction. All are in the same direction, they are all coming in the same direction. You'll get that. That is your final beam coming out. But to remember that here, it is in, not in optical, but it is in infrared. It produces in infrared. For NDR, the final output is in infrared. Now, okay. Okay, so next what we have is semiconductor. We will do semiconductor laser later. So let me stop the sharing. Now, any questions you have from yesterday's and today's class regarding this process of, okay.